Amen. Good morning. Welcome to Lighthouse Baptist Church. We're sure glad to have you all with us here this morning. And we're excited to worship the Lord together today. As you all find your way in, let's all stand together and make room for everybody else. We're going to start with singing, I Sing the Mighty Power of God. Let's sing it together this morning.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or flower below but makes thy glories known, and clouds arise and tempests blow by order from thy throne. While all that borrows life from thee is ever in thy care, and everywhere that we can be, thou God art present there. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders this world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth.
Crucified, let's sing.
Crucified, laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took up hope and thought of me.
A God who's all-powerful. He can do anything. And the same God that's all-powerful is the same God that sits on heaven's throne still today. He's above all. And he's still in charge of everything that's going on in this world. And sometimes it might feel like everything in this world is getting out of control, but I'm glad no matter how out of control the things in this world may seem to be, it's all still under his control. And he has a sovereign, powerful hand, and that's a great truth to celebrate in this day and time. Well, as we continue with our service, be mindful that some people might not want to shake hands right now, but why don't you turn around and greet your neighbor and welcome them to the service today.
Thank you.
as you find your way back to your seat, I hope you got a friendly greeting to your neighbor there. And we're glad you're all here at Lighthouse this morning. What a great time to come and celebrate our Lord together. We're going to join together and continue singing this next song, Standing on the Promises. I love this song. And we're going to try to play it a little bit like we did the songs last week. And so let's sing this song together, Standing on the Promises.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing and amazing, standing and amazing, standing on the promises of God my Savior.
Place to stand right there on God's promises. Well, as we continue this morning, let's pray and ask God's blessing on our service together here this morning. And as we go to prayer, I'm going to ask for Brother Gene Patton, if you'll lift up your voice and open us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this house of yours that we may come to worship. We're thankful for these that are here and the many, many blessings that you continue to give. We pray, Lord, that you'll be with the service. Pastor, as he brings the message to us as we're to receive, we pray, Lord, you continue to look after us and watch for each one of us. We also think of those less fortunate. Pray for them, Lord, that things can get better. Lead us and guide us in all things. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated, and welcome to Lighthouse Baptist Church this morning. Great crowd today, and we're excited to have every one of you here. And I know many of you are church family and regular attenders, but some of you are guests, and we especially want to welcome you to our service together here today. We always love having guests at our church. If this is your first time with us, or maybe your first time in a long time, we have a I want to recognize you for that. I'll not call you out or embarrass you during the service, though. This is how we do that. We have a connection card, and on this connection card, you can just put your name on there and whatever information you're willing to share with us here this morning. We'd just like to get to know you a little bit, and then hold on to that with you, and after the service, you can actually, on your way out in the lobby, just drop that off at the welcome desk if you would, and regardless of whether you fill out our little card, we have a gift we'd like to give to you if you're a guest with us here today, and I hope you'll grab that on your way out. We love having guests with us, and we'd like to honor you for being with us here as a part of our services here today. And so thank you for being here with us. Now, several things I want to talk to you about before we take up our offering this morning. The first thing is we are in the middle of a small group series right now. It's a series called When You Just Can't Get Over It. And it sounds almost like it's almost a comical title, but boy, it deals with a lot of issues that we have a tough time getting over. And I tell you, it's a blessing. It's already been a blessing to our people that have been going through it. And I want to encourage you, if you're not a part of a small group, that is where you really get to know people that are a part of our church. And I want to encourage you to become a part of one of those. And I'll also say, for those of you young couples and young adults in the room here today, we are starting a brand new small group on October the 8th, I believe it is. It's going to be on Thursday evenings, and I want to encourage you to become a part of that small group. The leaders of that group are actually sitting right back here. And Brother Andy, could I have you raise your hand for me? Brother Andy Lohman, no stranger to us at our church, and his wife are going to be leading that group for us. I am super excited about this group, and for young couples and young adults, and I think it's going to be very helpful. So if you're in that category and you say, I'd like to be a part of this series, I'd like to join a group, or you're interested in it, just put your name on a connection card and mark on there that you're interested in small groups, and we'll contact you with more details about those things there. And that's all very good. One other thing I'm going to mention to you right now as well. This last Friday, Emily and I went over to Bill and Terry's house, still again, and they are starting an initiative in our community to pray to pray for the abolishment of abortion. And we're actually going to be going over to, there's a Planned Parenthood clinic that's here in our city. It's going to be on Tuesdays it's open on Tuesdays and Fridays. And regardless of where you stand on this issue, I want to encourage you to, of course, if we're Bible believers, we support life and we support the sanctity of life. And I don't shame away from saying that. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, the Lord said about Jeremiah. And God is for life, and we ought to be for it too. And we're gathering out to pray outside of the Planned Parenthood. We're not there to protest. We're not there to cause a scene. We're there to pray. We're there to pray for the sanctity of life. We're there to pray for moms who might be faced with the difficult circumstance of having to deal with an unexpected decision, perhaps. We're there to encourage them to do what's right. And that's the reason we're doing this. And I want to encourage our church to be a part of it. And so if you're interested in being a part of going over there and being a part of this initiative and leading in prayer and going over there and having a presence, I don't know what the Lord might do with this. It wouldn't hurt my feelings if Planned Parenthood in Cortez, Colorado closed down. And I say that sincerely, because I believe in the evil of abortion. I believe it is evil, and so I want to encourage you to pray about supporting this cause. It's a worthy cause, and we need revival in our country. There's no doubt about that. And one of the greatest national sins that is staining our country's history is abortion, and the innocent lives that are being taken away. And we as God's people, if anybody should stand for truth, if anybody should stand for what's right, we as God's people should. And I'm always careful when I talk about this subject because some of you may have had an abortion. And I want to tell you, God loves you. Jesus died for you. And we don't look at you any different. And we don't judge you for that. But we do believe in the sanctity of life, that being said. And I appreciate Bill and Terry. Would you guys raise your hand back there? I appreciate them leading this initiative. And I encourage you to talk to them. And if you want more information, you can also call the church office, and we'd be happy to give you more information about that as well. All right, let me have our ushers come forward at this time, and we'll prepare to worship the Lord through our giving together here. And appreciate your faithfulness in giving to the Lord's work and supporting our missionaries. And God has sure been faithful to us this year.
Good morning. As we get ready to take off the offering this morning, pastors asked me to ask you, if you would, to pray for our president and vice president and the choices that they are making for a chief justice, and that you would pray that it would go smoothly and we would find someone there that's conservative. And so if you would do that, it would be greatly appreciated. Brother Keenan, would you pray for the offering this morning?
come together and worship you, and we pray for our nation's leaders, dear Lord, in this very critical decision that's in front of our president, our vice president, the Senate, dear Lord, that will shape, have a big impact on this country's direction and laws for many years to come. We pray that your wisdom and your guidance be on all of our leaders' decisions, and in that regard, dear Lord, and we ask that you bless this service, dear Lord, and the message, and bless the offering of meet the needs of the church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This next song we're going to join together in singing together, I tell you, this is a song we're going to be singing throughout all of eternity. It's a song, we call it the Revelation Song, because it comes from the book of Revelation, where the Bible says in Revelation chapter 5 and verse 12, that all the saints one day will gather and say with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and such as are in the sea and all that are in them heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth on the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever." You know, one day we're going to be gathered together in heaven, and we're going to be singing together as the Church of Jesus Christ, saints throughout the ages, this song. I don't know if it'll sound like this or not. Probably won't. But I'll tell you something, we'll be singing this song, and we get a little taste of heaven on earth every time we come together as the church. Every time we come together, we get to come together in anticipation of that day, singing "Worthy is the Lamb." And so let's do that together right now. I want to invite you to stand with me, and let's sing about our Lord's worthiness together here today.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Thank you.
the Lord for that blessed hope we have one day we'll be united in heaven to sing that song together. I want to encourage you to get your Bibles out this morning and go to Genesis chapter 31. Genesis chapter 31 in your Bibles. Right before we get into the message from the Scripture, we're going to hear a message in song from our very own Ethan Gray. And I'm looking for him. Where are you at, Ethan? Oh, he's right there. Forget, he's the guy behind the camera. And I'm going to brag on him for a minute before he comes up here because for many of us, especially during this coronavirus thing that's been going on, especially in the early days when we were all quarantined and we couldn't have public services, this man was such a blessing in helping to make sure we were able to do a live stream. And he's been a constant, constantly working at it to improve things, and I appreciate that, and I want to acknowledge him for that today. And I know he didn't do it for the acknowledgement, but he's been a blessing to all of us, really, through this whole thing that's been going on by being behind that camera and making sure things are working to the best of our capabilities here with what we have. And so thank you for that, Ethan, and he's going to come and minister to us in song this morning. Thank the Lord that He washed our sins away. That's a blessing. Genesis chapter 31 in our Bibles this morning. And looking forward to jumping back into our series in the book of Genesis. And we'll begin in the mid part of Genesis chapter 31.
Some of you may remember we had preached up to the middle portion of this chapter, to verse number 16 of chapter 31. We're going to pick up in verse number 17 and through the end of the chapter, Lord willing, here this morning as we continue studying the life of Jacob. Now, some of you might remember from the last time we were in the book of Genesis, we began to read about Jacob's life. He'd been married, had some kids, and God appeared to him and began to give him a pulling on his heart to go back home. And then he began to give him a push by putting him into an uncomfortable situation with his uncle and father-in-law. And it ultimately led him to surrendering to go back towards God's purpose for his life. And so this is the predicament that Jacob found himself in. He talked to his wives about it, and they decided it was time for him to go back home, as God was leading him to do. But that decision came with some consequences. It came with some difficulty. And the place that Jacob found himself in, we could describe as being a place that's between a rock and a hard place. Some of you ever heard that phrase before, being between a rock and a hard place. That's the type of circumstance Jacob found himself in, because behind him was his uncle Laban, who was also his father-in-law, consequently. And all the unresolved issues there, he didn't want to talk to Laban, and he was running from that. And in front of him was some more unresolved issues, those with his brother Esau. It's Jacob. Remember, when Jacob left home 20 years before, Esau wanted to kill him. That's how mad he was at him. Both behind him and in front of him, Jacob had some serious issues. He was between a rock and a hard place, and he found himself in this difficult position in his life. And as he was trying to go about doing what God was directing him to do, we find that it led him right to this place where we could say he felt stuck, and he didn't know what to do. He didn't know how to get out of it. And I wonder if you've ever been in a position like that in your life. A position where you feel very much like you're stuck. You begin to go in the direction you know God is leading you to go, but it seems like it puts you right in between a rock and a hard place. It seems like it puts you in the middle of a no-win situation where it seems like no matter what you do, the consequences don't seem favorable. It puts you right into this place where you feel stuck. And I say to you this morning, sometimes God, the only way that he can truly set you free to accomplish his purposes for your life is by giving you nowhere else to go but to deal with the issues of your past. And God put Jacob into this situation to make him face some issues that would have haunted him for the rest of his days. That's why God put him into this situation. And if you're in a situation today where you feel stuck, it very well may be why God has put you into that situation as well. And I'll say to you, when you feel stuck, when you come to a place in life when you feel stuck, you ought to thank God for it. God often brings us to those types of places to save us from living a life of regret or restraint. Living a life always looking over our shoulder. Living a life defined by some hurt from our past or some fear in our future. That's not how God wants us to live. And so God put Jacob between a rock and a hard place to set him free. And that may be why God has put you into the position that he's put you in today as well. So as we look at the scriptures here in Genesis chapter 31, I want you to notice with me four merciful ways that God will lead you through the hard places of life. Four merciful ways God will lead you through the hard places of life. As we go to break open the scripture here, I want to bow our heads and close our eyes, and I want to pray. And I want you to pray along with me. Listen, this is not an easy message. For some of you, it may be all too close to home. But I promise you, I wasn't hiding in your closet this week and figuring out all the things you're going through, okay? But the truth is, this message has hit closer to home for no one else but me. And I say that in all sincerity. Confrontation is not my forte. I tend to be a little bit like Jacob. I'd rather run away than run to the problem. And yet we all need to understand how freeing it is to face this type of issue the way God tells us to. And so let's pray and ask God to speak to our hearts. Father, we come before you this morning. We ask that you would open up your word to not just our minds, but our hearts, Lord, that we might be able to receive the truth you have for us today. You know the individual needs much better than I. You're the omniscient one. You're the all-knowing one. And you know what each person needs from your word today. And I pray that you'd feed your people through your word today as only you can. I'm trusting you with that, Lord. And I pray for your enabling to communicate your truth with a spirit of grace. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Four merciful ways we see from the life of Jacob how God will lead you when you come to the hard places of life. Number one, if you're taking notes, you can write this down. It's this: God will prevent you. The first way God will lead you is that he will prevent you from doing something you shouldn't do. Now, notice what the Bible says in verse 17. If you're with me, say amen. The Bible says in verse 17, then Jacob rose up and set his sons and his wives upon camels, and he carried away all his cattle and all his goods which he had gotten, the cattle of all his getting, which he had gotten in Padan Aram, for to go to Isaac his father in the land of Canaan. Verse number 19, Laban went to shear his sheep, and Rachel had stolen the images that were her father's, and Jacob stole away unawares to Laban the Syrian, and that he told him not that he fled. So he fled with all that he had, and he rose up and passed over the river, that's the Euphrates, and set his face toward the Mount Gilead. Now, the fact that Jacob was doing what God had told him to do, remember, it was God who had put the pull on his heart to go back home. It was God who had pushed him and said, you need to go back to the land I promised to your forefathers. And it was God that told him to go, and the fact that Jacob was doing what God told him to do was commendable. What was not so commendable was how he went about doing it. You see, the fact is, Jacob determined to do God's will his own way. Can I tell you, it never turns out good when you try to do what God wants you to do your way. We try to teach this to our kids all the time. We tell our kids, we want you to do something. And they have a roundabout way of doing it, you know. Well, I'll clean my room when I get around to it. No, ma'am, you'll do it right now. I think so. And we have a different agenda oftentimes, even as children, than our parents, and even so we are with God. And Jacob went about doing what God told him to do, going home, but he didn't go about doing it the way that God would have desired him to do it. He left avoiding conflict. And here's the interesting thing we see about this. Verse number 21 describes how Jacob departed when it says, so he, what? Fled. He fled with all that he had. Jacob ran away like a coward. He didn't want to face Laban. He didn't want to face the conflict that inevitably he knew he should have faced. And so he turned tail, he picked up his family, and he stole away in the middle of the night. And you know, Jacob didn't have to flee like a coward. God is the one who had told him to leave, and he could have went and stood before Laban with every confidence in the world that he was doing what God wanted him to do. But instead, he chose to flee. And you listen to me, and you listen to me well. Whenever you find yourself running away in fear, whenever you find yourself rushing into something to escape responsibility, you can bank on it. It's probably wrong. It's probably wrong. See, the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, that God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. God has given us his love, his power, and a sound mind to be able to make wise decisions no matter what it is that we're facing. Furthermore, the Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 19 and verse number 2, that he that hasteth with his feet sinneth. If you're rushing into something, you can mark it down. It's probably not right what you're trying to rush into. It's probably not the right direction that you're trying to take. And so often, it is in trying to avoid what we know we should do that we go to great lengths to be able to get around it. Sometimes we put ourselves to more work trying to not do what we know we should do. Oh, come on now. I know this is where we're at. I know this is where I'm at. And we so often are this way, just trying to avoid what we know God has clearly revealed we ought to do. Proverbs 28 and verse 1 informs us that the wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous are bold as a lion. Can I tell you something? Look at me. There will be no need for you to flee if you know that what you're doing is right in the sight of God. There's no reason to hide. There's no reason to flee. There's no reason to trying to get away with something if you know that what you're doing is right. But Jacob was forced to flee in this scenario right here. And interestingly, Jacob had enough faith to depart like God had told him to, but he didn't have enough faith to depart the way God had told him to. And that is always a prescription for disaster when you try to do God's will your own way. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 12 that there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. I'll tell you something. You're going the way you think is best. You are not going the right way. I'll guarantee you that. I like what the Bible says in the book of Proverbs chapter number 16 and verse 9. It says, a man's heart devises his way, but the Lord directs his steps. I summarize that verse with these words. God directs, I decide. God directs, but I decide. See, God would be willing to lead you if you'd be willing to listen to him. But it's your choice. You can go God's way, experience his blessing, or go your own way and experience the consequences of making that choice. The choice is up to you. How much better is it for just do God's will, God's way? Amen? And so Jacob learned this the hard way here in this passage of Scripture. But in spite of all of his scheming, this is the wonderful thing we see in this first part of this account in Scripture. God was ever working behind the scenes. He was working behind the scenes, preventing Jacob from getting away with something that God knew was going to hold him back for the rest of his journey. Notice what the Bible says in the next verse, in verse number 22. It says, and it was told Laban on the third day that Jacob was fled. And he took his brethren with him and pursued after him 7 days' journey, and they overtook him in the Mount Gilead. Now Jacob, he lived 3 days' journey away from Laban. Now we discovered earlier in our study in Genesis, the reason for that was so that their cattle wouldn't get mixed up. And so Jacob, he lived 3 days away. And so Jacob knew as soon as he left, he had at least 3 days before Laban was going to find out. And so he leaves, and I'm sure Laban was regularly sending people to check in on Jacob and make sure that things were going the way he wanted it to go. And Laban finds out 3 days later that Jacob's gone. And boy, when he finds out, he takes off in a huff and a hurry to try to go catch up to him in this situation here. And I like what one guy said about Laban. Laban, he was shearing sheep here, but he was usually shearing Jacob. I mean, he was a guy who just took advantage of Jacob time and time and time again throughout what we've studied in the Scriptures thus far. I'm going to switch to this microphone because this one's just really scratchy right now for some reason. All right, there we go. Hopefully that won't be distracting for all of you here now, okay? But as soon as Laban found out that Jacob had fled away, the Bible says that he ran and took off after him. And here's what we find in this first part of this chapter is simply this. God prevented Jacob from getting away with avoiding something that he desperately needed to face in his life. The story of Jacob would have read a lot differently if Jacob hadn't faced this issue in his past. And God knew it was important that he dealt with this issue from his past. And I say to you this morning that God is still at work today preventing his people from avoiding the issues he knows will keep them from being able to fully and freely follow the purpose he has for them. If God brings you into a situation where you're stuck, you're between a rock and a hard place, it seems like a no-win situation, God's brought you there because he doesn't want you to go on without facing that insurmountable obstacle, that issue from your past. That's why he's brought you there. And you need to own up to that. That is the work of God in your life. And so how will God lead you when you come to the hard places of life? Number one, God will prevent you. But number two, note this down, God will protect you. He will protect you. If you're still with me this morning, say amen. Amen. All right. Well, we find as the Scripture continues here in verse number 24, that it only took Laban's caravan 7 days to catch up to Jacob. Now, it had taken Jacob's caravan 10 days to travel that same distance. And we have a little map of the journey they took up from Haran going down to the Mount Gilead and this mountainous region in northern Jerusalem there. And it was a journey of about 300 miles, we know today. And it's interesting, we crossed over the Euphrates River. There's a lot of things we could say about it. But, you know, the Bible says that they traveled by camel. Now,
I don't like to travel by car for 300 miles. I can't imagine what it was like to travel by camel. But I did some research on this because I'm weird. But, you know, a camel can go about 25 miles a day. All right? I have a picture of a camel. There you go. I love camels, okay? There is a little pet thing, or a little animal thing, not too long ago over here at the Elks Lodge. It was a couple years ago. We took our girls to it. They had camels. It was awesome. I love camels, okay? 25 miles a day is what a camel can go. They went 300 miles, approximately. And so Jacob was pushing his camels about 5 extra miles a day than what the normal camel can go. He was pushing his camels 30 miles a day, but boy, I tell you what, Laban, he was mad. He was pushing his camels 45 miles a day. He didn't care if those camels lived or died. He was mad, and he was trying to get to Jacob in a hurry, the Bible tells us here. And he was furious that Jacob had run away, and he was going to make him pay. And you understand, there was a reason why Jacob felt compelled to run away. Laban was no guy to be tampered with. And that's why he felt like he needed to run away. And so Laban finally catches up to Jacob, the Bible tells us. And yet, before he gets to do what he wanted to do, he wanted to teach Jacob a lesson. I'm sure he wanted to hurt Jacob. But the Bible says before he got to do that, God prevented him. And the Bible tells us in verse number 24 that God came to Laban the Syrian in a dream by night and said unto him, "Take heed that thou speak not to Jacob, either good or bad." God stopped Laban dead in his tracks from fulfilling the intentions of evil that he had against Jacob. And Matthew Henry said, "God warned Laban to say nothing against Jacob's going on with his journey, for that it proceeded from the Lord." And I'm going to tell you something this morning. You be careful about trying to turn someone away from God's direction for their life. You be careful about that. God told Laban, "Don't you try to stop him. I'm the one that told him to go that way. Don't you try to stop him." And so before Laban even had the opportunity to do anything to Jacob, Jehovah God had showed up and said, "Laban, stop." And I love it. With one word, with one dream, with one vision that God gave to Laban, he stopped him dead in his tracks. He tied his hands, and he made him stop from the intentions that he had against Jacob. And so in all this, we see the protective hand of God over Jacob as he chose to live his life by faith. It reminds me of the story I heard of an Anglo-American individual, a man who had citizenship in England and in America. He was visiting a foreign country, and he had been captured by an extremist group. And the extremist group had put him up for ransom to both England and America because he had dual citizenship. And so some ambassadors from both England and America came over to work out the negotiations for the ransom. And when they walked in to where their fellow citizen was, where he was being kept as a prisoner, as the story goes, the British consul first stepped forward and took out a British flag and draped it over the back of the man. And then the American consul, in like fashion, took out the stars and stripes and draped it over the back of that man. And then they looked at the extremist group, the guys who were standing there, and they said, "Fire on him now if you dare. Fire on him now if you dare." I tell you, I like that story because, well, number one, I'm an American, and I really like that story because don't mess with America, okay? But number two, it reminds me of what God did for Laban here, or what God did for Jacob. God shows up to Laban and says, "Laban, don't you touch him. He's mine. Don't you touch him." And essentially, he threw his banner over Jacob, and Laban couldn't do anything. And can I tell you, when you determine to do God's purpose for your life, when you are pursuing his purpose for your life, you can be sure about one thing. You have God's banner of protection over your life. Sometimes we feel like, especially when we come to hard places, well, if I talk to them, everything might fall apart. If I talk to them, I might lose this, I might lose that. If I deal with that issue, who knows? God will protect you. So long as you are doing what God has led you to do, you can be assured of the protecting hand of God. And the protecting hand of God was further on display as we continue with the chapter here. The Bible says in verse 25, "Then Laban overtook Jacob. Now Jacob had pitched his tent in the mount, and Laban with his brethren pitched in the mount of Gilead. And Laban said to Jacob, 'What hast thou done, that thou hast stolen away unawares to me, and carried away my daughters as captives taken with the sword?' Wherefore didst thou flee away secretly and steal away from me, and didst not tell me that I might have sent thee away with mirth and with songs, with tabret and with harp, and hast not suffered me to kiss my sons and my daughters? I'm sure Jacob, the whole time Laban's talking, is thinking, you're a lying scumbag. You wouldn't have done any of those things. I mean, all Laban has done is treated them wrong. But he's trying to justify himself here. And Laban goes on to say, thou hast done foolishly in so doing. Verse 29, it is in the power of my hand to do you hurt. But the God of your father spake unto me yesterday night, saying, take thou heed that thou speak not to Jacob either good or bad. And now, though thou wouldest needs be gone, because thou sore longest after thy father's house, yet wherefore hast thou stolen my gods? There are several things Laban revealed about himself here. One of the first things he revealed is his bias. See, Laban, he wasn't going to be convinced that he was wrong. Laban's approach in confronting Jacob was, I'm right, you're wrong, you need to agree with me. He was not willing to own up to any of his own mistakes. We see he was very biased. We also see he's very bitter. As he comes to Jacob, he's still mad at Jacob because God's blessed Jacob and God hasn't blessed him as much. He's mad at Jacob that he has all of the cattle, he's got all the success, and he's still bitter about the fact that God had blessed Jacob and not blessed him. And so we see that he's very biased, we see he's very bitter, we also see he's very blind. Hey, the last thing he asked Jacob about is, where are my gods? Now what kind of a fool would put his faith in gods that somebody can steal? What kind of a fool would do that? What did you do with my gods? It's comical to me. But the really sad thing about this whole thing is just the night before, Laban had seen Jehovah God in a vision. Now, I don't know about you, but I feel like if I would see Jehovah God in a vision, if I'd see God in a vision, that I would have a mind to believe in him. I would have a mind to make him my God instead of these little idols I've been holding to my whole life. But that's not what happened. With Laban here, he decided to hold on to his faith in these false gods. And so Laban's in a very bad place, and he's coming, and he is bound and determined to prove that he's right and Jacob's wrong in this situation. But I love how Jacob responds here at first. Jacob responds honestly and humbly. Notice what he says in verse number 31. The Bible says that Jacob explained himself by saying, because I was afraid, for I said, peradventure thou wouldest take by force thy daughters from me. And with whomsoever thou findest thy gods, let him not live. Before I, brethren, discern thou what is thine with me, and take it for thee. For Jacob knew not that Rachel had stolen them. Hey, what I love seeing here from Jacob is that Jacob owned up to his fault in the matter. Now, a lot of the things that Laban accused him of, he wasn't guilty of. But Jacob admitted where he was wrong. When you mess up, fess up, right? And that's what Jacob did. He said, Dad, you know what? I'm wrong. I shouldn't have run away. I didn't want to talk to you. I didn't want to face you, and so I just ran away. And he owned up that was because he was afraid that he had run away. But on the same token, Jacob stood up for his integrity. Jacob knew that he had been honest, that he hadn't stolen from his father-in-law, that he hadn't done a thing wrong the whole time he worked for him. And by the way, when you have a good testimony, when you work with some ethics, when you work with some integrity, that gives you some confidence to stand on. And that's the kind of practice that all of us should have in our workplaces. But Jacob said, you go ahead and look at every one of my tents. Look in every crook and cranny. I don't care where you look. You're not going to find that I've taken anything that's yours. And Laban, he's still bound and determined to prove himself right, to vindicate himself. Notice what he did in verse number 33. The Bible says, and Laban went into Jacob's tent and into Leah's tent and into the two maidservants' tents, but he found them not. Then went he out of Leah's tent and entered into Rachel's tent. Now Rachel had taken the images and put them in the camel's furniture and sat upon them. And Laban searched all the tent, but found them not. And she said to her father, let it not displease my lord that I cannot rise up before thee, for the custom of women is upon me. And he searched, but found not the images. Ironically, the master deceiver, Laban, gets out-deceived by his own daughter. Hey, they say train up a child in the way he should go, right? Well, it has reverse effects too, okay, I'll tell you. And the master deceiver gets himself deceived by his own daughter. And he trained her well in that respect, I suppose. But Laban didn't find a thing that was his in all of his searching within Jacob's tents, the tents of his family. And boy, it's interesting here. Jacob, He's so confident in his integrity. He's so confident that there's no fault in his life. And it's almost challenging to me, because if my enemy came to me, I had to think for myself, would I be able to say, go ahead and look at my house. Go ahead and look at my life. See if you can find any fault, anything that I've done wrong. And that's what Jacob did to his enemy. And he was found faultless. He was found blameless in the whole scenario. It's actually very convicting when you think about it. But Laban, he wasn't able to vindicate himself. But I'll tell you, this is the other form of protection we see here. See, before, God had protected Jacob when Laban was coming to do evil against him. But now, Jacob had some issues in his own home he didn't even know about. Because guess what? There was something stolen within his house, wasn't there? Who had stolen it? Rachel. Rachel had taken her family's teraphim, the little ancestor idols, out of the house there. And she was hiding them. And Jacob had no clue what was happening at that point in time. But we see God's protection again. God was protecting Jacob from facing the consequences for things that were issues in his own home he didn't even know about at that point in time. And I'll tell you, it reminded me of something. There are so many issues in every one of our lives. I know me especially, more times than I can count. I've been overcome with a fault in my life. And yet God in his grace still is the one who's always faithful, who watches over our life and protects us even from ourselves sometimes, from falling in the pits and the traps that we don't even know are issues in our home at the time. And that's what happened for Jacob here. And so I'm thankful for our faithful God, who, as Jacob was just trying to pursue what God had told him to do, both from without and from within his own home, God was protecting him. God was leading him on. And God had brought him to this hard place to teach him these things. The first thing that we learn is that when you come to the hard places in life, that God will prevent you. God's going to stop you and lead you to deal with your issues. The second thing we learn is that God will protect you. The third thing is closely related to that, and I want you to see this third thing here, and it's that God will preserve you. God will preserve you. Now, Jacob had been wronged. Jacob had been cheated by Laban for years. He had been unfairly chased down and stopped. He had been falsely accused now. But in all these things, Jacob had remained calm. He had responded humbly and honestly when Laban came and stopped his caravan and pointed a finger in his face and began to accuse him of things he hadn't done. Jacob had remained calm through all those things. But when Laban started to go through all of his stuff, he opened every box, he overturned every bed. I'm sure he was looking everywhere to try to find those things that he thought were his. Jacob stood there, and his anger began to boil. And the Bible says in verse number 36, and Jacob was wroth. That means he began to get hot. Now, you know what that's like, right? It's like the temperature's rising here. You're getting red in your face. He started to get hot, wroth, and he chode or strove with Laban. Jacob started getting burned up with anger, and he was ready to make somebody pay for it. And that somebody happened to be Laban here. And so he exploded on him. And the Bible says that Jacob answered and said to Laban, what is my trespass? What is my sin that thou hast so hotly pursued after me? Whereas thou hast searched all my stuff, what hast thou found of all thy household stuff? Set it here before my brethren and thy brethren, that they may judge betwixt us both. This 20 years have I been with thee. Thy ewes and thy she-goats have not cast their young, and the wrens of the flock have I not eaten. That which was torn of beast, I brought it not unto thee. I bear the loss of it. Of my hand thou didst require it, whether it was stolen by day or stolen by night. And thus I was. In the day the drought consumed me, and the frost by night, and my sleep departed from my eyes. And thus have I been 20 years in thy house, Laban. I served thee 14 years for thy two daughters, and 6 years for thy cattle. And thou hast changed my wages 10 times. And except the God of my father, the God of Abraham and the fear of Isaac had been with me, surely thou hadst sent me away now empty. God hath seen mine affliction and the labor of my hands, and rebuked thee yesternight. After 20 years of being abused, after 20 years of being mistreated at the hand of Laban and keeping his mouth shut, there came a point when Jacob couldn't be quiet about it anymore. He reached a boiling point, and he exploded all over Laban. just laying out all the injustices, all the things, all the ways that he had been mistreated. And by the way, it is a token of God's grace at work in Jacob's life that he had indeed changed, because he used to be just as deceptive as Laban. For the past 20 years, he'd been a man of integrity. He'd been a man of honesty, and he made no qualms about it. And even though he'd been made to bear the cost of all Laban's losses, even though he'd been given no per diem, he had to come up with his own food. He had to figure out his own place to live. Laban had given him nothing. And even though he had been, his pay had been changed or cut 10 different times, the Bible says here, Jacob had remained honest through all of those years, trusting God to deal with Laban. And now he was fed up with it after being falsely accused by Laban. But the most significant part of Jacob's defense of himself here is this. Jacob acknowledged the Lord. He honored the Lord, who he recognized had preserved him through all of those injustices. Look at verse 42 again. Verse 42, the Bible says, "Except the God of my father, the God of Abraham, and the fear of Isaac had been with me, surely thou hadst sent me away now empty. And God has seen mine affliction, how you've mistreated me, Laban, how you've changed my wages, how you've done all these things to me. He's seen mine affliction and the labor of my hands, how I've been honest, how I've been a man of integrity before you. God's seen all this and went and rebuked thee yesternight." Jacob realized that through all the injustice he had been made to endure those past 20 years, that God was the one who had preserved him and had provided for him every single step of the way. And you can mark this down, friend. You can mark this down. The person, the one who preserves the way of his saints through injustice, through the difficult seasons of life, is God. God has not forgotten about you. You're being mistreated in your home. You're being mistreated in your marriage. You're being mistreated in your workplace. God has not forgotten about you. God knows what's going on. The Bible says in Psalm chapter 97 and verse 10, "Ye that love the Lord hate evil. He preserves the souls of his saints. He delivers them out of the hand of the wicked." God looks out for his own. You listen to me. You start trying to take your preservation into your own hands, and that's when there comes issues. The Lord's told us that vengeance is his, that he'll repay. And he does so in his own way, in his own time. It's when we try to get back at people in our own way, in our own time, that we cause a lot of issues. We try to vindicate ourselves. And Jacob acknowledged that it was God who had preserved him, God who had stood up for him through all of these things that took place, and how important that is right there. And so God, we see his preserving hand on the life of Jacob as he came to this hard place. And when you come to the hard places of your life, when you feel like you're stuck between a rock and a hard place, God will prevent you. He brought you to that place so that you would deal with those issues in your past, so that you can go on with the purpose he has for your life. He'll prevent you. But as you go through that hard place, you can be sure God will protect you and he will preserve you from injustice. He will preserve you through it. Those are the reassurances that we need to hear if we're going to deal with it. Because those are probably the things that hold us back the most from dealing with confrontation, from dealing with the hard issues of life. We don't know what's going to happen to us. They've been unjust to us in the past. Who's to say they're not going to do it right now? It takes faith in God, who is our protector and our preserver, to deal with those issues. And this is something Jacob needed to learn here. But the fourth way we see God will lead us through these hard places of life is that God will bring peace to you. God will bring peace to you. Now, after hearing Jacob's defense of himself, Laban, he was no doubt infuriated himself. And I'll just not park on this long. I'll just say this. Hey, when you are dealing with issues of confrontation, the book of Proverbs, I think I have this in your notes, it says a soft answer turns away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. Okay? It's like the classic story of the husband and wife. Stop yelling at me. I'm not yelling at you. Yes, you are yelling at me. And it just escalates from there. Okay? And that's how we are as human beings. A soft answer, though, turns away wrath. Jacob didn't give a soft answer, and he got a very upset response from Laban. And the Bible tells us about it in verse 43. It says, "And Laban answered and said unto Jacob, these daughters are my daughters, and these children are my children, and these cattle are my cattle, and all that thou seest is mine." Not true, not true, not true, not true. "But what can I now do? But what can I do this day unto these my daughters, or unto their children which they have borne?" Laban essentially said, "All this is mine. But your God's protecting you. And if I tried to do anything to hurt you, I'd be hurting my own family. There's nothing I can do." And so here's what he said and went on to say in verse 44. "Now therefore, come thou, let us make a covenant, I and thou, and let it be for a witness between me and thee." Can I tell you, this is what I believe Laban indicates in these verses here. Laban knew he wasn't a good father. His own daughters early in this chapter have said, Dad treats us like we're foreigners, like we're strangers, like he doesn't even notice. He doesn't care about us. Laban knew he was a bad father. He knew he was a bad grandpa. He knew he was a bad employer. He knew all that in his heart. But he would not acknowledge it. He would not own up to it. That's the sad part of what we see is happening here with Jacob. But what I do believe we see here is that he did try to make up for his shortcomings. And, you know, as I look at Laban, there are so many Laban-like men that I have known. And let's just go ahead and say it's mostly us men that struggle with this. Those three words, "I am sorry," we really struggle with that. You say, "Well, you don't know my wife. She struggles with it too." Okay, well, that's fine. But I'm just going to go ahead and throw us under the bus here, okay? Laban, he struggled with it. And he never apologized for his years of abuse. But in his own way, he tried to make things right. In his own way. One of the most juvenile things I've encountered in my few years of pastoring is those people who come up and say, "Well, they didn't tell me they're sorry." Well, boo-hoo. And I say that with all sincerity. It's juvenile to demand an apology. My 6-year-old does it. My 3-year-old does it. Now, should Laban have apologized? Yes. But here's the thing. As Laban comes and tries to make things right, Jacob recognizes it. He says, "You know what? Let's just put it behind us." You know, you might not be able to get the person who hurt you to own up to it, but you can recognize if they're willing to take a step in the right direction. But your choice to forgive them must not be contingent on them asking for forgiveness. It must be contingent on the forgiveness you've experienced from Jesus Christ. "Be a kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another," the Bible says, "even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you." If God, for Christ's sake, forgave me of all my sin, of which I was not worthy of being forgiven, I, for Christ's sake, can forgive you. I don't care what you've done to me. That's what the Bible tells us. And that's what we see Jacob did here with Laban. And so the Bible tells us here, starting in verse number 45, how this alliance of peace, this covenant was made between them. The Bible says that Jacob took a stone and set it up for a pillar. And Jacob said unto his brethren, "Gather stones." And they took stones and made an heap. And they did eat there upon the heap. And Laban called it Jegersuhadutha. That probably was a butchering of the name. I do know it's a Syrian word that means a pile of testimony. And Jacob called it Galid. Thank you, Hebrew. You're so much easier. But that's the Hebrew word for the same thing, a pile of testimony. And so they set up these stones as a pillar to be a memorial of the fact that they made peace with each other on this day. And then the Bible goes on to say that it was, verse 48, that Laban said, "This heap is a witness between thee and me and thee this day." Therefore, it was called Galid. But then Laban also called it Mizpah. That word Mizpah is a name that means watchtower. And this is why he named it this, for he said, "The Lord watch," or "keep watch, between me and thee when we're absent from one another." And if thou shalt afflict my daughters, no man is with us. See, God is witness betwixt me and thee. And Laban said to Jacob, behold this heap, and behold this pillar which I have cast between me and thee. This heap be witness, and this pillar be witness, that I will not pass over this heap to thee, and that thou shalt not pass over this heap and this pillar over unto me for harm. Verse 53, the God of Abraham and the God of Nahor and the God of their father judge betwixt us. And Jacob swear by the fear of his father Isaac. Three things happen here. They set up these pillars as a witness of the peace arrangement they've made with each other. They set up these pillars to be a watchtower, a reminder that God was the one who was ever watching over the outworking of their arrangement. And they set up these pillars as a warning as well. And Laban said, I'll never cross these rocks to come hurt you, and you never cross these rocks to come back over and hurt me. And I tell you, in a real way, they were both making a decision to put all their issues behind them so that they could go on. Now, how many of you have ever heard of the Mizpah benediction before? It's in a lot of old hymn books. And the Mizpah benediction, it's conveyed as being a very friendly thing. It's actually not very friendly in the scripture. God looks at Jacob and says, if you mess with my daughters or you break this arrangement, then God is witness and God's going to deal with you for it. And that's the kind of thing that happened. It kind of reminds me of the guy when I first started dating my wife. I was at Bible College in California, and there was a man who was a police detective for the L.A. County Sheriff's Department. And she was very close to this family, and he came to me. And when I started dating her, he pulled me over to the side when she wasn't watching. And he said to me, son, I want you to know I'm a detective in this county. I investigate all the homicides in this county. I can kill you and hide you out in the desert and nobody ever know about it. So you better not break her heart. And I said, yes, sir. That's what I think of when I think about Laban's agreement here that he made with Jacob. You don't hurt my daughters or I'll hurt you, boy, or God will hurt you worse. But they came to some terms of peace here. And you know what's funny to this about me? The Bible says when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. And in the end, as Jacob decided to follow by faith the direction God was leading him to go, God brought him to a place of peace, even with someone who used to be his enemy. And here's the crowning point of the whole thing. Don't miss this. Look at verse 54. Then Jacob offered sacrifice upon the mount and called his brethren to eat bread, and they did eat bread and tarried all night in the mount. Hey, listen to this. It was ultimately Jacob's connection to the God of peace that brought peace between these two enemies. Laban set up a pillar, but Jacob offered a sacrifice. And that goes back to what I said a moment ago. Ultimately, the only way that we can experience true reconciliation, true forgiveness between people who have hurt us is as we understand the forgiveness that Jesus Christ has offered to us. That's the only pathway to being able to truly let issues from the past go. And Jacob offered up a sacrifice honoring the God who had brought reconciliation, who had brought peace in this situation right here. And I'll tell you something this morning. When you are at odds with someone, you will never deal with it. You will never reconcile it until you first reconcile things with God. And what I mean by that is, hey, if you've been wrong, you need to acknowledge before God that you've been wrong. If you never get to that place, you'll never acknowledge it to the person that you are at odds with. And that's something we see demonstrated by Jacob's sacrifice in this passage of Scripture. I like what one person said. He said, to forgive is to set a prisoner free, and then to discover that the prisoner was you. That's what forgiveness is. I'm going to give you a final illustration before we're done for sake of time here this morning. When I was a teenager, we experienced a break with the church that we had been going to. The pastor had done some things that we didn't agree with. We tried to work it out, but make a long story short, we had to leave the church, and it was very painful, very hurtful, especially for me as a 15-year-old boy. And for years, I was mad. I was bitter at that pastor, okay? I was a homeschooled kid, And so I didn't have school friends. I had church friends. And when we left the church, there went all my friends. And my reasons might have been juvenile for why I was angry, but for years I held on to that thing. And it came to a point when I was at a juncture in my life, when I was in college, where God brought me to a screeching halt in my life and prevented me from going on until I dealt with that bitterness in my heart. And I remember God dealing with me about it, and I remember going home on a Christmas break from college, and while I was there, calling up this pastor, this man who had caused me all this hurt, my family all this hurt, and I asked if he could meet with me. And to be honest with you, I don't think he had a clue how much he'd hurt us, how much he'd hurt me. I'm sure he just thought, oh, it's one of my old preacher boys coming to talk to me. No, I didn't want to talk to him. I didn't consider myself one of his preacher boys. We went and sat across the table with him at breakfast at a Bob Evans place back in the East. We sat there, and I began to tell him about all the hurt from the past. I began to look at him in the eye and tell him about the bitterness I'd held in my heart towards him for years. And I also told him how I wanted to ask for his forgiveness for holding that bitterness in my heart. I told him that I wanted to forgive him for what he had done to hurt me, to hurt my family. I like to say that he broke down and that he apologized as well and that he owned up to it, but he didn't. He didn't. But this is what did happen. He began to weep. He didn't apologize, but he looked at me and he just said one word, thanks. You know what? I had wanted him to apologize. I'd wanted him to admit that he had done us wrong for years. But as soon as that happened, that's all I needed to hear. And can I tell you, we both walked away from that breakfast table free men. I had forgiven, and he had been forgiven, and that was the end of it. And that has never dominated my life ever since. God brought me to a hard place to help me overcome something he knew was going to hold me back for years from pursuing the purpose he had for me. And I say to you this morning that when God brings you to hard places, he will prevent you from avoiding it. Listen, you may think, well, I've avoided this for years. I'll just keep on doing it. You'll do it, but it'll always be there. You'll never be able to get past it. You might be able to ignore it, but it'll always be there. God will prevent you, and then, hey, when you come to the hard places, you can be sure God will protect you and preserve you. God will give you everything you need to be able to deal with the issue. And eventually, the end goal is that God wants to bring you to a place of peace. He wants to reconcile that issue. He wants it to be forgiven and dealt with so that you can go on and do what he created you to do and not have that event define the rest of your life. God wants to give you victory today. Wouldn't you like to experience it? Wouldn't you like to learn the lesson that God wants you to learn through your hard place today? I want you to bow your head and close your eyes with me. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. God has allowed you to be in this hard place. It's because he cares about you. And because through it, he wants to truly set you free. How many of you would be honest this morning and say, Pastor, I am in that hard place today. There are some things that I'm dealing with. I feel like I'm between that rock and that hard place. There's some issues in my life right now that God has spoken to my heart about today very clearly that need to be dealt with. If that's you, would you lift a hand up this morning? Anyone else? Pastor, there's some issues in my life. I'm in this hard place right now. Please pray for me. I see those hands. You can put them down. Would there be someone this morning who would say, Pastor, I don't know that I'm saved. I don't know that I am forgiven by God. I don't know that I'm on my way to heaven. I am so lost right now. I don't know that I'm saved. If that's you, would you raise your hand? I want to pray for you. Pastor, I don't know that I'm saved. Please pray for me. Just lift your hand up and put it back down. I want to pray for you. Anybody like that this morning? I see that hand. You put it down. Anybody else? Pastor, I just don't know that I'm saved. Please pray for me. Amen. Whether you lifted a hand because you're in a hard place, whether you lifted your hand because you're not sure that you're saved, we're going to have a time of invitation now. It's a time where I invite anyone who God has spoken to your heart to step out from where you are, to come and talk to the Lord at an altar. You can pray in your seat if you like. I encourage you to come and talk to the Lord at the altar, especially if you raise your hand and you don't know Jesus as your Savior. Because here's what I'd like to do. I'd like to introduce you to a lady, if you're a lady, or a man, if you're a man, who can show you from the Bible how you can be saved today. You can walk out from here knowing you're forgiven. There's no greater assurance that you'll get in your life. And so if God is speaking to your heart during this invitation, I want to invite you to come. Let's all stand together with our heads bowed and eyes closed. And right now, as you stand to your feet, why don't you go ahead and step out from your aisle? If God is speaking to your heart, why don't you come give your burden to the Lord today? In the midst of your hard place, why don't you turn to the Lord today? You come as we sing. It's that first step that's the hardest step. But I promise you, you'll give it to the Lord today. You'll leave with some peace in your heart, knowing you followed what He was leading you to do. If you need to come trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, I invite you to step out and come. We want to help you today. But it's your choice. As these others have come, I want to invite you to come. Forgive, the prisoner is set free. That prisoner is you. You walk free from that burden. Walk free from that bitterness that has long held you captive. Give it to the Lord today. Singing on that chorus together. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our prize.
We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh, Jesus, we turn our eyes to you.
Let's pray together. Father, we come before you this morning and thank you for the opportunity to open your word. Thank you for how you've spoken to our hearts. And Lord, you know this is an area I struggle in with confrontation. But I thank you that you bring us to the hard places in life sometimes so that we have no other option. Lord, we have to deal with those issues because, God, you want to give us freedom and liberty to pursue your purpose for us. And I thank you for your mercy, your faithfulness, and the grace that you show in leading us through these times. I pray for those who lifted a hand today who are in such a hard place. Help them, Lord. Let them know your preservation and your protection. And I pray, God, that as they turn to you, that you would bring peace to them in their relationships, bring peace to them through those hard issues that they're facing in their life right now. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing there. And boy, thank the Lord for how He's working in hearts this morning. A couple of announcements I want to make to you here. We do have a baptism here in just a moment, and so we'll get to that in just a minute here. But we also have a family who is going to be being presented for membership to our church here this morning. And during the first service, we had a lady, Kelly Oliver, who came forward to join the church. How many of you know Kelly already? All right, several of you know Kelly, and she did come forward during the first service, and we'll need to vote on her for membership as well. She has been saved. She knows the Lord, been baptized after salvation by immersion, and that's an important thing, and so she is desiring to be joined together in membership with us as well. And then we have Larry and Joanne Felkins, who are also coming to join. Will you guys stand for me? And they're no strangers to this here. In fact, some of you might be surprised that they're not officially members yet because they've been so faithful and serving. And thankful for both of them. Had a great visit with them, talking about their testimonies and talking about how they came to know the Lord as their Savior. And they've both been baptized by immersion after they've gotten saved as well. And really been faithful to the Lord for many, many years. Been a part of several good churches. And we're blessed that they want to come and join together in membership with our church family here today. And so both for the Falcons and for Kelly Oliver, I would like to propose them for being presented as membership to our church family here. And all of you in favor of them becoming a part of our church family, would you signify by saying amen? And all opposed, the same sign. You know, nobody's ever opposed before. And that's a good thing. Welcome to the family officially. And I love this couple. I want to ask, after we do the baptism, if you guys would slip to the back. And I want to make sure people can officially welcome you to the church family. And we sure love them and thankful to officially have you guys as a part of the family. You could be seated there. And I want you, Miss Debbie, if you just play the piano for a moment, I'm going to slip back and prepare for baptism, and we'll do that here in just a moment. All right. Well, we're really excited about autumn coming today, and I was privileged to meet with both her mom and her. It was either 2 weeks from last Friday or a week from last Friday. I can't remember exactly when it was, but privileged to be able to open the Bible and talk with her about her faith. And she made the decision to trust Jesus Christ as her Savior that Friday right in my office. And that was a pretty special moment right there. And she wants to make her profession of faith public today by getting baptized. We know that baptism doesn't save us. It's a way to outwardly show what God has done in our hearts when we trusted Jesus as our Savior. And so she desires to do that here today. And we rejoice with her in making that decision. And so, Autumn, have you trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior? Amen. Well, I'm going to baptize you then. In obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior, in response to your public profession of faith in Him, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, buried with Him in the likeness of His death, raised in the likeness of His resurrection. Amen. Congratulations. Let me slip out this way. That's pretty exciting. And I thank the Lord for Autumn's willingness to make her faith public today. That's a blessing to all of us here. And it's pretty neat to watch what the Lord's doing in our church right now. And these are exciting days at Lighthouse Baptist Church. And I'm thankful for and give God all the glory for what He's doing. Let's all stand together and we'll get ready to be dismissed from our morning service. I want to invite any of you who are interested in joining our worship choir
to come back tonight at 5 o'clock. We're going to practice next week's songs and actually going to be introducing some Christmas music for our Christmas program later this year as well. And so 5 o'clock, you're welcome to come. Even if you can't sing, I might kick you out, but you can come. I'm just kidding. And then we'll have the evening service tonight at 6 o'clock. And so hope to see you all back there for that here in just a little bit. If you see the Falcons, make sure and tell them welcome to the family. And Miss Autumn will get changed here. And if you see her around, you can congratulate her in making her decision public today as well. And we give God the glory for that. Let's be dismissed in a word of prayer. And I'm going to ask for Brother Don Wilson, if you'll lift up your voice and dismiss us in prayer.
Thank you for the blessings that you've given our church over the past months and the past years. And Father, we just thank you for that. Be with us as we go home. Lord, give us a great afternoon. Bring us back together tonight here in your house to worship you. And Lord, we just thank you again for this day. We thank you for our pastor and watch over him. In Jesus' name, amen.